Ayo, and hello again! With Halo 2 coming out on the Master Chief Collection for PC, I thought it'd be a great time to release the new update to Rebalanced. And so, Halo 2 Rebalanced 3.0 is now available for both MCC PC and Project Cartographer. If you aren't already aware, this is a full campaign mod that buffs the weapons and vehicle sandbox such that everyone is viable with their own role, tweaking the player, the enemies, and the levels to be more fun, and so much more. All detailed in the first two videos covering this mod. This video will go over every notable change since 2.0, so let's get started. First off, credit to Toraburu for very recently discovering this. Master Chief and Arbiter now sport health bars above their shield meters. For the longest time, I didn't understand why certain Halo games completely hid away your health, so I'm really happy to be able to implement this. Just like vanilla Halo 2, your health will take 10 seconds after damage before it begins to recharge, and I've extended that recharge time to around 7 seconds or so. Now there's no more wild guessing as to what level of health you're at after your shields drop, and subsequently you can make better decisions in the heat of combat. For all of my rebalances so far, I've concocted a perfect set of movement values pulling from all the different Halo games. The player's movement acceleration and speed is now the same as Halo CE's, and the crouching acceleration, left, right, and back speeds are now the same as Halo Reach's. All remaining general movement is faster and smoother, helping a lot especially with Rebalanced's focus on being able to outmaneuver enemy projectiles and play aggressively, something which vanilla Halo 2 punished hard. Halo 2 strangely removed fall damage from CE, and while I couldn't find a way to add it back in, I did re-implement CE's hard landing stun mechanic, where falling a long distance will result in being stunned for a moment, just so there's a little more consideration in how you traverse environments. I've decreased the tracking of projectiles when shot by enemies, to be the same as when the player uses them. So now outstrafing things like the Needler Shards and the Plasma Pistol Overcharge Bolt is easier. And now for the weapon changes. I've given the SMG the exact same accuracy values as the 2.0 version of CE Rebalanced Assault Rifle, being that the SMG is basically Halo 2's AR anyway. The minimum spread is very accurate, while the maximum spread extends slightly outside of the reticle. This is to punish reckless firing patterns more at longer ranges, which in turn makes burst firing more meaningful. I've also made a few tweaks to the Brute Plasma Rifle. I've increased its maximum spread so you now have a choice between burst firing for better accuracy, or holding down the trigger to take advantage of the weapon's batshit insane max fire rate. Beware, however, as I've also increased the time it takes for the weapon to cool down after overheating. So the idea is that using the Brute Plasma Rifle is a balancing act. Very high damage per second, but greater punishment if misused. Both the Sniper Rifle and Beam Rifle were great weapons in Halo 2, but they've always been very similar in their performance and niche. So I set out to make them more distinct from each other. For the Sniper Rifle, I took inspiration from Reach, and gave it the ability to chip vehicle health. For Halo 2, this also means hitting the body of the vehicle will do extra damage to the driver. Then I made the weapon function like it does in Halo 3, a longer time between shots with upward recoil. In return, however, it now boasts a much higher damage, capable of one-shotting lower enemies and our favorite crackshot sniper jackals. That then brings us to the Beam Rifle. The weapon now does more damage to shields than its counterpart, meaning it's capable of one-shotting minor elites, two-shotting ultra elites, and instantly draining jackal shields. And to go along with its hyper-precise nature, I've increased its max zoom magnification to 12. The carbine has seen similar tweaks, as I wanted to give it more distinct role from the battle rifle. So likewise, the carbine also does much more damage to energy shields and jackal shields, with a decreased projectile speed so there's a greater need for leading shots. So where the battle rifle excels in landing headshots on grunts and brutes, the carbine excels in landing headshots on elites and jackals. And speaking of both the carbine and battle rifle, I'm sure we're all familiar with how they were our go-to utility weapons in vanilla Halo 2, allowing us to stay at a safe distance to insta-kill enemies from range, in turn making a lot of the non-headshot weapons redundant or too risky, especially on the game's vanilla insane legendary. This is a case of dominant strategy and something I paid great attention to, making sure there's no be-all end-all strategy and that the vast sandbox of Halo is put to good use. With this in mind, I've given a slight nerf to the battle rifle and carbine, in decreasing their bullet magnetism, which is a mechanic that skews your shots toward an enemy when your reticle is near them. This nerf makes using these weapons much more skill-based and emphasizes precision, being that they're the game's designated precision weapons after all, but also de-emphasizes them in close-range situations, just like how weapons like the SMG or plasma pistol are de-emphasized in long-range situations. My goal being that the battle rifle and carbine should stand among the rest of the sandbox, not above it. Lastly for weapons, I've buffed both Sentinel Beams to do more damage to non-flood enemies, and I've given the Eliminator Beam greater stopping power, making getting overwhelmed by them in a vehicle put you at risk of being flipped over. With that, on to vehicle changes. For every single vehicle, I've increased the damage threshold, which means more shots taken before vehicles will start showing visible damage. I've increased the Ghost Inspector's acceleration and left and right sliding speeds, to make strafing enemy shots more viable, which comes in particularly handy in Quarantine Zone's chaotic vehicle sections. And for the Spectre turret, to make it more distinct from the Warthog turret, I've decreased its projectile speed while having higher damage output. AI firing the Spectre turret also fire it much more accurately, but still lenient enough to where the player can outpace the rounds when used by the enemy. I've dialed the Wraith back to be a bit slower and have more weight to it. I've increased the amount of time between his mortar shots and have increased the damage per blast. I've made the Warthog Goss turret behave more like 3 in Reaches, having a slower rate of fire but with a much faster projectile speed. And the AI using it will fire it much faster than vanilla, but are also more inaccurate with it, making the Goss turret better for vehicles, while the chain gun is still better for infantry. For the plasma turret, I took inspiration from the Delta Halo cutscene, increased its rate of fire, and also increased the amount of indirect damage you can take, to make it more viable and fun to use. Let's move on to AI changes. I wanted to make the elites on Halo 2 more menacing, like the elites of CE and Reach, so they've seen a bunch of tweaks. First thing is, I fixed the MCC bug that disallowed elites from dual-wielding, so you'll actually be able to encounter elites wielding different types of weapons all throughout the game.
Yes, I have one blue eye and one green eye. Can we get on with it?
I've increased almost all elite ranks' health, because in vanilla Halo 2, their amount of health was ridiculously low relative to CE, so bringing their health back up helps to flesh out the backbone of the weapon sandbox, which is the dichotomy between plasma weapons stripping shields and bullet weapons stripping health. The minor and major elites' shield stun and recharge times have been buffed so that they can get back in the fight a bit faster after taking cover. Elites also stunned with every hit from sniper weapons and normal melee attacks, so I've removed those stun locking capabilities so elites can better counterattack and there's more skill involved in taking them down. I've greatly increased the Spec Ops elite shields, shield recharge time, and health, as well as with the Spec Ops grunts, so that these AI actually feel like the elite of the elites like they should. Spec Ops elites in Halo have always had the unique trait of being avid grenade throwers. I wanted to maintain that, so I've given them back their ability to toss grenades. But to make it less dangerous for the player in the Arbiter levels, I've made it so they'll refrain from using grenades if the player is within a certain proximity of their target. The grenade spamming is the trademark of the Spec Ops, but I still wanted the regular elites to be able to use grenades in some capacity, as ideally elites should be capable of everything the player is, just like they can dual wield and jack vehicles. So a great compromise I found was allowing lower ranking elites to occasionally throw grenades whenever the player's in cover, making for another dynamic element to spice things up. Lastly, for elites, I've made it so their melee attacks don't damage allies anymore, which goes a hell of a long way in keeping them alive in flood levels, where they can no longer whack each other, or even worse, bonk the player to death. Speaking of the flood, I took the same philosophy from my CE rebalanced and adapted it into Halo 2, where human flood are weak against bullet weapons, and elite flood are weak against plasma weapons. As such, I've made the majority of the elite combat form's vitality made up of shields, with very little health. I've also fixed the damage of the sword-wielding combat forms, so keep an eye out for these blue blade-wielding maniacs, as now they can actually kill you. For brutes, they've been given the ability to hop more often to make their behaviors a little more interesting, and for both the brutes and the flood, I've made it so their melees don't spin AI around anymore, which evens out the odds more in battles, especially when it comes to elite versus brute battles. For all AI who are capable of it, I've increased the maximum speed at which they will attempt to board a vehicle, so take care when going in for the splatter. To wrap it up for AI, I've increased the Enforcer's Needle projectile speed so that they're more of a threat that keeps you on the move. Next up, let's cover various changes to the levels. Since the Magnum didn't appear that often in Halo 2, and since I've buffed it, I wanted to give it more representation throughout the game. So, I've placed a lot more Magnums on Cairo Station, made a lot more Marines wield it, changed it to be the starting secondary weapon of Outskirts and Regret, and gave it more plentiful ammo. For this next edition, all credit goes to Scruffy the Sasquatch for letting me borrow it from Halo 2 Overhaul. The Marines at the Zanzibar Hotel have been changed to be ODSTs, to match up with the Day at the Beach movie. Using this method, I've also put more ODSTs here and there all throughout the rest of the levels. And again, inspiration from Halo 2 Overhaul, I added a second friendly Warthog at the start of the beach section on Outskirts, so that you have a helping hand in drawing enemy fire. Just like every game since Halo 3, I've made Grunt Heavies pilot a lot of the Ghosts, for the sake of greater variety in vehicle encounters. For Metropolis, the Banshees on the bridge segment now come from in front of the player rather than behind them. For the last vehicle encounter on that level, I placed many more Ghosts to feel like the larger battle scene in the Halo 2 E3 demo. On Oracle, since the combat forms are supposed to be former Heretic Elites, I gave all of them their same shield flare effect. For Sacred Icon, I placed a couple of rocket launchers to help you deal with a certain Sentinel Enforcer. I'll leave you to find out where they are, though. On Gravemind, I've added two extra Marine variants in Sergeant Stacker and Sergeant Banks. Since in Vanilla, you had five Marines, but only three separate voices.
If my face looked like a squid, I'd be angry too!
The Marines here will also use plasma grenades. I also thought it'd be cool to make it so the Brute vs. Elite battle in the First Garden was a fight between honor guards of both races. The Great Journey vehicle segments have seen an improvement to the vehicle variety with more wraiths and a few banshees being added. For the last vehicle encounter, more ghosts on the ground with ally elite banshees backing you up. Finally, I've made some more small cosmetic changes. The plasma pistol, plasma rifle, Brute plasma rifle, and carbine have all had their projectiles enlarged, because I think it improves the feedback loop for shooting and being shot at with these weapons. And since the Gosshog has been changed to behave more like 3 in reach, it's only fitting its projectile be likewise adjusted to fit with its new attributes. Lastly, both the plasma pistol and sniper rifle have had an increase to the volume of their firing sounds, as in vanilla they were both very quiet. So now they have more oomph to them. And there we have it. 3.0 of Halo 2 Rebalanced is finally out. I hope you enjoy playing this mod as much as I have, and I'm glad to be able to bring it to more people with MCCPC. These rebalanced Halo campaigns have been a blessing for me to make, as I already love these games so much. So with that said, I think we all know what's next. Stay tuned. To support me to make more mods, animations, or game analyses, contributing on Patreon really helps a lot. Like and sub if you feel so inclined, and I'll see you again soon. Peace.